Chipotle's wrong about a hot bag, it's just okay.
Okay, so today we're talking about, we haven't drank anything yet, I promise you. This is the three steps to taste and experience and begin to pick apart a whiskey and ideally give some tasting notes.
For context, the right way to try, drink, smell, and taste whiskey is often all the ways. So when someone says you should do these things, yes, do those things, but then also do the opposite because each thing that you do will teach you something totally different about the whiskey.
We were doing a video talking about like 10 whiskey hacks to get the most out of a whiskey. And there's a lot of tips and tricks that kind of different angles of approach for whiskey, but these are just the basic three steps you're gonna be doing. And this is assuming you even want to pick apart the whiskey. A lot of people that get into this scene and they feel like this compulsion, well, I guess I have to be analyzing everything that crosses my lips. Nah, if you think a whiskey is interesting enough to justify diving in at this level, then by all means, this is kind of like a really simplified, overly simplified three-step approach to picking apart a whiskey. The first step, what is this?
Smelling.
Yeah.
So the nose of a whiskey is your first experience with the whiskey.
Right. Whenever people talk about smelling, they'll often say on the nose. It just means I'm smelling this.
Yeah. On the nose, I'm getting... Yeah,
it just
means I smell these things.
There's no difference. It's now, it just feels a little fancier, that's all.
Keep in mind, smelling has all to do with the shape of the glass and your nostrils and whether one's stopped up or not.
Right.
Sometimes just the shape of your nose will affect whether or not you get a better smell out of one nostril than the other.
And the environment's a huge factor in this too. Like, we're inside right now, we're in the tasting room. The air is very still.
When it's windy, it changes.
Yeah. The most traditional way to nose a whiskey, there's an actual technique here.
There is, and that is to keep your mouth open and to bring the whiskey up to the nose until it starts to become too sharp and then back it off slightly.
Yeah.
And then give yourself time to think about what just happened. So you introduce, take a smell, pull it away, think about what happened. Introduce, take it away. Richard Patterson does this really well, but a lot of other people do. When you're smelling, if you open your mouth, you're letting the vapors bypass your sinus cavity instead of build up in your sinus cavity. It helps to keep things moving. What I'll find is that depending on where, if I put my nose right into the glass versus to the top of the glass, I'll get different things out of it. And if you agitate it, you'll get different things out of it. Now, what you're looking for in nosing notes is not an empirical analysis of what is in the glass. What you're looking for is, what does this remind me of?
Exactly. We recently did a video called The Tasting Truth Snobs Don't Want You to Know. And a big portion of it was the things that are subjective, very personal, whenever it goes from person to person and their experience in whiskey. There are things that are objective, things that can be measured. But for the most part, it's not like you're gonna be giving a wrong or right answer there.
If you're doing this without notes, you're making a mistake. And what I mean is not just taking notes, but if you can find a tasting sheet, even a wine tasting sheet, any tasting sheet, like the Whiskey Smiths do, for example, it will give you a list of here's some things that potentially show up in a whiskey nose.
Right.
And that's one of the best ways to find things, because if you just go in blindly, you're just hoping for the best. But if you go in looking at a list of things and saying, do I smell this? And going yes or no, that's actually easier for your brain.
If you don't have a tremendous catalog and archive of smells to be able to drop on, like a cheat sheet of things that are common in a given category are gonna be very, very helpful in helping you narrow down what you're actually smelling. Now in this whiskey, I'm getting molasses and like a walnut.
Molasses, walnut, a slight dusting, a rich kind of malty note.
Yeah.
And a little bit of old wood campfire, not fresh burn.
Then I'm getting a tiny bit of brown sugar and like a tea.
And then, like a black tea and then an almost oiled leather.
Yeah, it's interesting. Whenever you have your mouth closed and you just smell, you're gonna get a lot there, but it's gonna be kind of hard to pick it apart. If you take it a little bit more gradually with your mouth open and kind of breathe in and out with your nose and mouth at the same time.
And remember, like Rex said, you can't find patterns that you haven't built.
Right.
Your brain's pattern recognition machine, if you haven't built the patterns, you can't call on the patterns. And so until you've built whiskey patterns, your best bet is just to say, what does this remind me of that's not whiskey?
Sure.
Now the second part is at some point, you're gonna have to drink it.
Oh no.
I know.
No, this is actually an easy way to infuriate your non-whiskey nerd friends. If you're just sitting there and you're just living
forever.
It, right, and like, dude, come on.
Now keep in mind,
yeah.
If you can't smell anything, you can't taste anything.
That's true.
Or I should say, if you can't smell anything, you end up tasting only about 10% of what was there.
Yeah.
And so nose doesn't go away. So all of the steps build on the last step. Now we're getting into taste.
And it's an interesting thing. Some whiskeys, the nose will be very, very different than the taste.
Mm-hmm.
Other whiskeys, it's like, yep, I got it. I knew 100% what was gonna be in this glass.
And it's right, but yeah, not often. Now, keep in mind, what we're about to do is go into step two, and then we're gonna talk about how it affected step one, because you'll end up getting what's called retronasal.
Eric Waite mentioned this briefly. What is this?
What that means is, remember, you've got two ways to get to your where your nose can smell things.
Yeah.
Through your nostril, and through your mouth and your throat.
Right.
After you've swallowed and you spread all of the fumes of the whiskey across your mouth and you've swallowed it, then the fumes are gonna be coming from your throat and your mouth. They'll also come up, but they'll come up from the back side of your nose. The glass will smell different as well.
Okay.
You'll pick up different things because you're now collecting fumes from your mouth and from the glass at the same time.
Now, the taste of the whiskey, some people have asked, when you're drinking it neat, right? It's gonna, or it's often gonna be like cask strength, really high proof, a lot of alcohol there. How much am I even drinking? And I equate it to the first sip, as much as like a sip of a hot coffee.
Yeah,
just
fresh
enough,
hot coffee.
Yeah, just enough to get it in your mouth, to get the taste. You're just not shooting it.
And keep in mind, a whiskey will change as it sits there. So if you just pour it in and then take a sip, it will not be the same whiskey if you pour it in and 45 minutes later smell and take a sip.
Well,
let's sit. Now, first sip, just my rule is, and this is just a personal preference, just swallow it, don't mess with it. Just take a drink of whiskey.
Yeah, a lot more oak now than I was expecting on the nose.
You're looking for two things when you taste. You're looking for what you actually taste, the flavors, right? That's obvious. But you're also looking for how it feels. Is it oily? Does it burn? Is there a spice on your tongue? Does it numb your tongue?
Right.
Can you feel it in your throat, clingy? Can you feel it in your, so that's high oil content.
And this is another reason why there's not really wrong ways to do this, because what's gonna burn for one person, another person is going to be used to like 60% alcohol whiskey.
Or smoky and oily.
Right,
or
and they're
sweet.
They can, you know, drink all day and it's never going to be an issue.
And when you're tasting, first look at the basic categories of tasting. And you've only got the five. They're arguing about a sixth one, but you know, you got sweet, salt, sour, umami is the savory category.
Right.
Anyway, so you can just work your way through those. Is it really sweet? Is it more of a savory? And then what you do is you combine.
So let's jump back to actual specific flavors. For example, if we're getting sweet. So if we're giving tasting notes and we're, you know, sharing the experience of what we're having with that whiskey, then the next question is, after we've given a very general taste, what kind of sweet? The more you are able to start, and it's kind of like a vanilla sweetness. Or it's like a dark, rich molasses.
And somebody said this really well in the tribe last week, which was, don't stop at a word. Always try to take that word apart too.
Right.
So when someone says, oh, I get a little bit of vanilla.
Yeah.
Don't stop there.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a lot of kinds of vanilla.
Sure.
There's vanilla bean, there's vanilla ice cream.
Really? Vanilla icing?
There's vanilla extract, right? And the metallic vanilla icing, like you said. Yeah.
So there's like a latte coffee vanilla.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's like a cream and that coffee bitter. Now the second sip, I'll spread it across my tongue and my cheek without swishing it, just move it around, and I'll often do that for the time. Different people like to say you do that for 10 to 12 seconds.
Sure.
Some say it's less.
Sure.
Some like to aggressively swish it around.
Yeah.
Your mileage may vary.
It's whatever helps you get the most out of that whiskey. You're trying to figure out that nice balance between getting enough to be able to pick out as much as possible, but not so much that it's like just a wall of flavor and it's overwhelming.
Well, now that we've given this a little bit of time,
right,
I'm starting to get more savory and less sweet notes out of it.
Yeah.
Like it's getting a little more wood bitter and a little more smoky.
That's okay.
Right?
So not buttery, meaty savory, but like a matured wood kind of savory.
But if you really coat your whole palate with it,
mm-hmm,
what you get is an almost astringent black tea note.
Yeah, like
almost, when you squeeze the tea bag out into the glass instead of letting it just sit.
Yeah, so now we're talking about after you give, you know, a general note like savory or sweet or oaky, and then trying to just dig down further, get more and more specific.
So we've got nose, then we've got palate, now we've got finish. And finish is gonna be what stays behind, what lingers. Is it coat in your mouth? Does it vanish and go away?
Right.
Does it leave sweet or savory?
Now, the whiskey's out there though, that's, you know, the very first second you taste this thing, you get, you know, all of these different flavors, all these different notes, and then it unfolds, it evolves, it melts into something else. And there's some whiskeys where, without exaggeration, it's like up to 15 seconds of flavor and note, and then a combination of this thing.
Now that almost
thing.
Only ever happens if you have a really oily whiskey.
Yeah.
Because it's coating your mouth and staying behind.
This isn't a hard set rule, but a rule of thumb is that's also gonna come from whiskeys that have had time to mature, get a bit older.
And often pots still. And if you truly love a whiskey, you should be trying it over and over and over.
Right.
Different environment, different time of day, after different food, before and after different whiskeys.
Right.
With or without water, with or without ice.
In the Whiskey Tribe communities, there is a type of post of content that I want to start seeing a lot more of. Because we have like the whiskey purchase ceremony. It's like, great, you got a new bottle. You got the bottle down ceremony because you polished off that bad boy. One of the things we don't really get is the in-between of those two bookends, which is the
how did
actual,
they drink?
Yes, what was the whiskey like?
Yeah.
What was your experience? And specifically, your experience with that whiskey. Because one of the cooler things about being in a whiskey group is even if you're not able to get your hands on a particular whiskey, you better damn well believe there's gonna be somebody in the community that has had that whiskey, and to the extent that they are ready and willing and able to give notes and flavors and their experience on the nose, on the palate, and the finish, then you can start to decide, is this something I really want to try and hunt down?
And so the more you see people reviewing whiskey and the more you go, that's what I got, the more you get insight into things that you haven't yet tried that they talk about.
Okay.
How do we do it?
We need to have, we're gonna have, this is what you do. Okay, this is plan B for the ceremony, because the first ceremony, here was the idea.
It's a good idea.
Look, you get the camera, and then you get the flashlight from your smartphone. And then, oh, that thing just glows, man. Look at that, put it on the flashlight, that's amazing!
But there's a small problem.
Which is?
How do you photograph that now?
That version works, if you got like multiple things. That is a tasting ceremonial photo, absolutely.
If you're alone and you only have your own camera,
right.
It is
bam,
this.
Right there, the presentation of the whiskey on top of the bottle, and hopefully even on a thin bottle, that should be able to go right on top. What's the ceremonial song, Daniel?
Should we consult the shuffle gods?
Oh yeah, this.
All right.
No, this is what I want you to, so go to Spotify.
Okay.
This is, go to Spotify.
Wait, okay.
And then go ahead, type in sing-along, all one word, because I will at least narrow it down to a sing-along. Just shuffle.
Okay.
Oh. Daniel.
Yeah.
I know you're trying your best, but why don't you let a real singer do this?
All right.
Oh, can't you see? It tastes like space to me. Watching you.
Chipotle's wrong about our bag, it's just okay. I love an Isla, it's like a cat of mace. I tip the bottle and I can't wait. I don't really care what the neckbeards say. Keep crying, whiskey, whiskey, please.
Everybody